Dworkin. Ronald Dworkin, an American born in Rhodes Island in the United States of America in 1931 and died in the year 2013, Dworkin is attracting both political and legal philosophers alike. Dworkin is relevant to us today, and in disregard of the space and time, Dworkin is pinpointing the pragmatic aspect of the knowledge of law and justice. But who is the real Dworkin? We better understand Dworkin using the historical backdrop. We are concerned with whatever was taking place around the world. By that time, it would be even more difficult to comprehend and apprehend in depth what Ronald Dworkin is speaking about. Let us give a quick overview and analysis of the historical background of Dworkin. Dworkin being born at a time that led to another tragedy in the world. The Second World War makes Dworkin more advanced as a positivist thinker, and the atrocities that came thereafter too had shifted the jurisprudential paradigm at that time. Remember that before the 19th century, or sometime early 19th century, the world legal thinking was dominated by the natural law theory, in which law was part and parcel of the morality, and that is the law of nature, known to us through the power of reason. And our thinking, our reasoning about the law is what would be understood as the meaning of law. This actually shifted in early 19th century when Jeremy Bentham and his colleagues and students came up with legal positivism, the approach that was backed by the empirical sciences and the modern thinking about the law that would be guided by the scientific methods, empirical methods. And what is law, according to this school of thought, would be basically what is the law, law as it is, as opposed to law as it ought to be. Law should not be understood looking beyond what the law is. That is law as the statute, law as posited, law as an enactment of the Supreme Parliament. Of course, this is making reference to the United Kingdom system, in which there is parliamentary supremacy, and what Parliament enacts into law is what is indeed the law. Anything beyond that boundary would be considered extraneous and non-legal issue whatsoever. Well, this is what led the thinkers such as Hans Kelsen to come up with the pure theory of law, to look at the normative sense in a way that the rules are subjected to a system that is experimented, observable, and inferences are made backed by such observable phenomena of the law. But this could only be done if the law is in writing. So the written law, lex scripta, overrides the unwritten law, or lex non scripta. This notwithstanding, another historical event happened. The Nazi party in Germany was democratically, legally, and procedurally elected into government. And Nazi Germany got into the helm of the coercive state authority in the lawmaking, that is parliament, and also the law enforcement body, the policymaking, the executive under the Chancellor Adolf Hitler, but also the judiciary, the judges. Having the majority in all arms of government and having powerful influence over the entire decisions, political decisions made by the government upon the people, that is what brought the world to untold historical tragedy, an injustice, a criminal offense known as the Holocaust. But even the occurrence of the Holocaust in the Nazi Germany, it was the question of the positivists that saw that whatever was guided by the rule of law, the rule of the statutes, the written constitution, would be considered justice according to the standard of the legal positivism. This is actually what has changed the mindset of the thinkers such as John Rawls and Ronald Dworkin, together with Norsik and other thinkers such as Hart, Ratz, and Lon Fuller, John Finnis. Having this kind of tragic moment, the philosophers of law and politics took into consideration the questions of justice. They took into consideration certain ethical issues, morality, things to do with justice, regarded with the concept of the principle of dignity, human dignity, and also principles of equality, the principles of rights, democracy. This is where the entire debate on what justice is in a liberal democratic space started. It is good to put it clear so that we understand why John Rawls looks at justice from one aspect, whereas Dworkin looks at justice from another aspect. We have looked at Rawls prior, and Rawls considers the basic structure of the society as that of comprehensive doctrines that must be institutionalized, must be formed into political outfits that would actually make decisions and come up with political policies that would safeguard the liberty principle. Liberty principle, as seen by Rawls, is from the libertarian philosophy, which dominated the Western world during the time of the utilitarian philosophy, in which the maximization of the utility looked at the majority, that is the community benefit, or what would really impact the community positively. That is the group rights, which of course is different from the individual rights that is emphasized under civil and political rights. That is the individual rights, in which when we speak of equality, we must address carefully. In this case, Rawls looks at the principle of liberty as the basis that must be founded within a political society and must define the basic structure of that society. Then the principle of equality that Rawls seeks to define using the original position and the veil of ignorance, in which people as individuals have got no knowledge whatsoever of where they will be or what they are going to be in the society. And they are put to make rules that would define the distributive justice as to what should go to where and what should be allocated to what. So that is the dividing of the national cake, for instance, in which such an individual who is totally unknowledgeable of his or her fate in that particular society would tend to be neutral and would make justice. So justice seen in this sense is backed by the libertarian philosophy and the liberal democracy in this thinking and analysis. But Rawls also was aware that indeed the human society is pluralistic. There is multi-ethnicity in the United States of America, for instance, and people are diverse in their thinking, in their rights, and there are so many or multiple rights and divergent rights that can only be accorded the luxury of the principle of difference, in which Rawls sees the need to have a kind of political consensus or a political system that would allow some consensus among the individuals. So the individuals consenting to certain principles that would define equality, that would actually deal majorly with whatever is considered the differences among the individuals. Some individuals are not naturally gifted or are not lucky to be like others. Some are able, some are disabled, some are maybe having low IQ, some have higher IQ, some are born with certain deformities, which of course is not of their choice. And in that regard, we cannot pinpoint a status in which such equality is designed around the principle of liberty or liberal democracy in this sense. Dworkin instead seeks to address the question of justice, starting with the concept of equality, saying that in politics, the most important concept is that of equality. Equality understood from the egalitarianism means that if every individual is considered equal, that means simply that they must possess equal wealth. They must have equal bank accounts, equal savings, equal investments, and they must also share the concept of happiness equally and what is good life for them, and that must be done equally. Dworkin finds problem with this approach to equality using the libertarian approach of Rawls and proposes the question of principles. Remember that Dworkin is also known for his perspective on the interpretative aspect of law, and that is actually bringing the discourse of morality, in which we can be able to tell whether the law enacted by parliament is good or not. And that is what defines also the judicial review, in which the honorable courts can rule against a certain law by saying that it is not good or it is bad. In this case, we are engaging our thoughts in moral exercise, which of course the previous or the traditional legal positivism was totally opposed to. This is what I call the shift of paradigm in the analytical jurisprudence. And the jurisprudence that is opening up the horizons to moral philosophy, to ethics, such concepts as dignity belongs to moral philosophy other than the legal philosophy or the legal format. Such things like equality can only be understood using moral principles. And in that case, Dworkin seeks to emphasize more on the principles and totality of values. He is putting the law, morality, and equality together with the political concern. In that case, Dworkin is not opposed totally to the political society, but what Dworkin is putting before us for our scrutiny is clearly stated in his works, the interpretative aspect of law, the law's empire, the taking rights seriously, as well as the Justice for Hedgehogs, which of course was published shortly before he died, that is in 2004. However, still Dworkin is proposing the following, or putting the following problem before us. The first problem he's looking at is, how do we see the equality from the egalitarian perspective, the equal distribution of resources in a society where justice means equality? In this case, Dworkin is concerned fundamentally with the two key principles to make this short. The first principle is the equal concern of the dignity of individuals, because that is the universal or shared dignity or shared principle. In that case, any coercive government must have equal concern of the dignity of the individuals. The second principle that he emphasizes under this category is that of equal respect of the choices that individuals from time to time do make. And in this, he again proceeds to look at such choices using two criteria. One is that of ambitions. Ambitions means that all choices we do make, for instance, what house to possess, what type of car to ride on, how much money I should spend, and how much money I should, and what type of job I want. These are what he considers ambitious kind of choices that people make at liberty and within a democratic liberty. But this must also be seen against another aspect, which he refers to as endowments. Endowments are our natural realities, which of course do not depend upon us as individuals or upon us as persons, such as to which gender I belong does not depend on me, to which society, which community, which ethnic group I belong does not depend on me, to which nationality at birth does not depend on me, and also whether I am fully capable of handling certain things or I'm born with some kind of disabilities, that does not depend on me. So there are certain choices that are not available to the individuals by nature or by the virtue of nature. This is where Dworkin seeks to intermarry the pure traditional legal positivism with the advancement of the legal positivism within the context of the liberalism and democratic space, in which he emphasizes on those principles that would be put together to formulate into certain values, which of course he describes in his publication known as Justice for Hedgehogs. Hedgehogs are known to be meek and small animals, but this legend of the hedgehogs comes from ancient Greece, in which Archelaus defined the question of foxes and hedgehogs, and it was cited by one philosopher by the name Isaiah Berlin. Isaiah Berlin quote here in the book of Dworkin says that the fox knows a lot of things, but the hedgehog knows only one big thing. The big thing here is the value, the good life, how to live well. And this is what matters in a value system, or a system formed by a standard of values. Dworkin putting to us this kind of argument is making a very pragmatic analysis of the human society backed by the concept of equality that must take into account the distributive justice, how the society distributes the resources equally among its members. And this can only be done having the principles before the rules, and putting the principles above the rules in any society, because such principles form a value system, which of course the community itself is acknowledgeable of, and tis the society within the concept of the constituent power of the people that can decide which are the values for us and what is to be the good life for us. But also as individuals, of course, Dworkin, together with Rawls, make a huge contribution to the Western concept of individualism. Those are the individual rights that are civil rights and political rights. In this context and this kind of approach of argument, Dworkin seeks to point at an ideal society that is backed by values and principles. And that is what the law is supposed to be designed to serve. And that is where the interpretation of the law should be anchored upon. And according to Dworkin, any justice system, any judicial system, any legal system is underpinned by a system of values, a system of guiding principles that should make the understanding of the principle of equality clearer and more accurate to the understanding of the distributive justice. It would have been a very lengthy lecture series, but I've decided to pinpoint at what has really informed the thinking of Dworkin, and that is his historical background. I invite you to keep on following this video channel, and our takeaway from this kind of lecture is very prominent, considering the political philosophy and legal philosophy of both Rawls and Dworkin. Thank you and bye for now. And remember to press the notification bell down there. Insert your comments so that we exchange on this platform.